Hello, everyone. It's Mary McDonnell here and Mina Sharp. Mina, want to say hello?
Hi, everyone.
I love the way she does that. We're here today with a very special guest. Many of you know, but for those of you who are coming into Lady Bam podcast first time, we welcome you. We're about to talk with an incredibly powerful female artist in the theater. Emily Mann, who has been the artistic director at the MacArthur Theater at Princeton for 30 years, a dear friend of mine. We've collaborated many times over the years. During her tenure at the MacArthur, the theater won a Tony for Outstanding Regional Theater. She was twice nominated for Tony Awards as a playwright and director, and her other numerous personal awards include the Peabody Award, the Hull Warriner Award, and the Dramatist Guild, etc., etc., etc. Awards from the NAACP, Opie Awards, Guggenheim. Emily kicks ass. Anyway, so Emily is such a beautiful playwright. The way I met Emily was I did an incredible play of hers, Still Life, a docudrama about Vietnam years ago. She has done famous interpretations of classic plays. Tennessee Williams was a collaborator of Emily's. I could go on and on about her experience in the theater, but after this, after you meet her, go look up Emily, because it just gives you hope for what's possible for women in the theater. And when you hear some of the stories she's about to tell us, you'll be even more impressed with what Emily has been able to create, and we look forward to seeing what's next. So without further ado, Lady Bammers out there, we present to you Miss Emily Mann. Hello, everyone. Here we are with our second Lady Bam during the time of COVID. And our very, very, very special guest, and many of you who listen and follow this podcast and follow my career closely and will be very familiar with our next guest. And those of you who aren't have just heard her resume. So Emily Mann, our dear, dear national treasure, Emily Mann, please say hello to everyone.
Hello, everyone. It's such a pleasure to be here with you. Oh, this is
now,
wonderful.
Here's the thing that you all don't know out there is that we're actually Zooming this. So Emily and Mina and I can see each other because, as you know, in previous times, the people that we would interview for the podcast were sitting in the room together and we would show you pictures of the cheese and wine we were eating and drinking and things like that. So now just know that we three Lady Bammers can see each other. And I think that it kind of helps everyone to have a little bit of a visual during these times, anything that helps us feel like we're in the same room at any point is helpful. So Emily, when thinking about speaking with you, which we have done many of these in a way, we've talked a lot about our amazing good fortune in meeting each other and the work we've done together, but I've never had an opportunity to ask questions about your life and your process and things about you that I know, but never in all the years, never had that extra half hour at the bar with a glass of wine to say. But when Edward Albee said to you, blah, 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 or whatever, you know, whatever it is. So I want to start. Well, first of all, I want to ask you how you are. These are extraordinary times. We haven't talked to each other face to face in a few weeks. So how are you doing?
Well, I suppose like everyone, I have my good days and I have my more challenging days. This happens to be a good day, maybe because I knew I was going to speak to you today. But also, it's an interesting moment for me because I'm about to have the celebration of my 30 years on Saturday night, which is 2 days from now.
It is.
And so it's a very emotional time to both be dealing with a huge life transition and ending, which I hope will also be a new beginning, but also dealing with the end in some ways of our profession as we knew it.
Yes.
I run a theater and we were just discussing a minute ago how what we do is communicate and tell stories live. It's live. And when are we all going to be able to gather again to create all of that together and then share it with our beloved audiences again? So it's a tumultuous time, emotionally, with all of the confusion. Everyone has different confusions that have to do with the uncertainty and the tragedy of this moment. And then on my good days, I see silver linings, and I see how we have to go back to basics, and how this is forcing us to make a complete and total reset, and how much I enjoy being in my home and just being with my husband and finding a way to reach out every day to my son and grandson, and finding a way to reach out to my friends in different ways and write and write and write. So I'm finding, you know, beauty in it. I'm also seeing how indomitable the theater community is, that we will not be stopped from trying to tell our stories. When we go on Zoom and start telling stories, or like Richard Nelson, the playwright, he just premiered a play that all took place on Zoom. It's about this moment in time, and the same family has been writing about now for 10 years and get together at different moments of extremis in our society. Got together because one of them had COVID. They're all quarantined. They all meet together on Zoom. And it was a wonderful play, but using the medium of Zoom.
Yeah.
So it was, you know, everyone saying, I don't know how to, wait a minute, where's the gallery view? Wait a minute, you're muted, unmute yourself. All this crazy stuff that was part of the play. So, you know, we can't be, you know, muzzled. We can't be shut down, really. No, we're going to find our way through this. And on my good days, I really know that.
That's wonderful, Emily. In terms of your next moment, after you are no longer in charge of this extraordinary thing you've created for 30 years, I do know that you are writing, and you just mentioned that you are writing to us. Can you talk about what you're writing? And I also have been privy to something you have been writing for a while, and I think you're moving along in that process. Are you able to talk to the public yet about these projects, or do you feel you're
sure
protected? Oh, good.
Yes, I think I'd enjoy it. One of them, I just finished the first draft of the book of a new musical that I'm writing with Lucy and Carly Simon. And Susan Birkenhead has just come on as the lyricist. And we're just having a fantastic time together. So I finished writing that first draft during my quarantine. And the other piece, I think you've read, Mary, already, which is an adaptation of The Pianist, a gorgeous memoir written right after the First World War by a man named Spielmann, who was a Jewish artist, a pianist of great renown in Warsaw. And it's how his life and the life of his family changed from one day to the next, once the Germans invaded and his family was taken to Treblinka and he was the only one to survive. Mm-hmm. It's a beautiful story of the power of art to keep one sane.
But wait, so tell us, Emily, about your history writing about the Holocaust.
Okay, well, the first play I wrote,
Anula,
was called Anula, an autobiography. Yeah. And right. It was the life story of, in her own words, it was based on an oral history I did of her, of how she survived the Holocaust in Poland.
It's all been in Poland.
And the reason for that, of course, is my mother's family came from Poland. One, her father's family came from Warsaw, and her mother's family came from a small town outside of Warsaw. We know that her entire family, except for her mother and aunt, who got out early, were all killed in the town square in Poland.
Right.
And that was a huge trauma to my mother, and then was passed down to me. And I learned about that young. And then my grandfather's family, we don't know if they died in the ghetto or they died in Treblinka, because the records aren't clear, but they were all killed.
Right.
So I knew about that early on as a young person, and it shaped me and it formed me in so many ways. I look at the world through the ethical lens of the Holocaust.
Well, when you were a younger woman, and I don't know what age this was, but I remember reading a story, sort of the synthesis of you wanting to create story around the Holocaust and your emotional connection to the Holocaust. And you're sort of the beginning, perhaps, of the light going off that you could be a documentarian. That wasn't there some story about you and your dad? He had something on his desk.
Yes.
Oh, that you saw. What was that?
Oh my God, Mary. Yeah. I was a junior in college, I remember, because it was over Christmas break, and in those days you'd never got a vacation. That was when you wrote your papers to be sent in. And I was procrastinating, and I was sitting at my father's big desk, and my father was an American historian professor, and there were this stack of manila folders, and I just happened to open one, which I shouldn't have done, obviously it was his private work, but I opened it and it looked like a play, but it wasn't. He was the head of the American Jewish Committee's oral history project on survivors of the Holocaust. It was a young woman sitting with her mom in their kitchen, and I said, you know, I'm sitting in the kitchen of my mom, the Upper West Side, and we're having tea, and I finally got to ask her the question.
Now, wait a minute. When you say it looked like a play, do you mean it looked like a photograph from a set of a play, or it was
The manuscript.
The manuscript.
Had stage directions, and then it had the girl's name who was interviewing her mother, and her mother's name and her dialogue.
I see. Yes.
And the one part of it that I remember vividly was she said to her mother, "Mama, you've never let me ask you this, but how did you survive?" And she had been in Theresienstadt, as I recall, that was the camp. And she had been a principal ballerina in the National Ballet of Prague. Mm-hmm. And she said she lay in the bunks with people all under and above her and for the side of her, people who were dying, people who were starving, people who were ill. And she said, "I just kept picturing in my mind this image of perfect beauty. I saw myself on point in a spotlight with my tutu, my costume, and a man, you know, my partner holding his fingertips at my back, and I was perfecting a turn in light." Wow. And she was sure that's how she survived. Just lost it.
And you were 18?
No, probably 20.
17? Oh, 20. Okay.
And I said to my father, "Can I turn this into a play?" Thinking he would go, "Well, sure." He said, "No."
No.
He said, "This belongs to the young lady who made this interview, and it's going into the archives of the American Jewish Committee." And then the next day, I came down for breakfast, and at my seat was a tape recorder.
Oh.
And he said, "You go make your own."
Oh.
And that started me. I guess chills when I think about this, that he was so amazing. And so I got this $150 grant from Radcliffe to travel to Europe with my roommate, Irene, who was on a similar grant to trace her Jewish family throughout Europe and get their history. And I wanted to go to my grandmother's village, Ostrowenka, where they had all been killed. And what happened was, I did that, but I got waylaid in London with her aunt, who was just so funny and wonderful, one of the most theatrical characters I met until Bessie Delaney, right? I mean, just phenomenal. And so we taped her and went on, and we did go to the villages, and I did go to my grandmother's village, and we were clearly at that point, this was before Poland had decided to fess up to what they had done to their Jewish population. When my friend Irene spoke Polish, and she tried to get the records of the family. and we were thrown out of the town, just spat upon totally. Well, I was amazed. Thank goodness my grandmother had made a map for us. She had where, here's where the river is, here's where the Jewish part of town was, here's where the synagogue was. And, you know, all through Poland, we had no money, so we would eat white fish, gefilte fish, right? And it tasted different in every town we went to. And we got to my grandmother's village, and there along the river was a little cafe, and we sat down. We were famished and eaten for a day. And it was my grandmother's gefilte fish.
Oh, my gosh. You recognized the taste.
Oh, yes.
Isn't that beautiful?
So it was our friend Timmy Neer. It started out as a monologue for Anula, Irene's aunt.
Right.
And then when I told Timmy, our dear friend and colleague, Timothy, about this, she was directing it in St. Louis. She said, Emily, that has to be in here. So she interviewed me, and then we intercut my voice throughout the play, and it became Anula.
Is that how that happened?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, that's so great. I love learning this.
Yeah.
All right, but I want to go back to the moment where you saw this manuscript on your father's desk and you saw it as a play, potentially. Mm. And then he gave you a tape recorder. There's a saying, there's a feeling, there's a, in my background and currently in this sort of meditations I'm doing out of this abbey in Ireland called the Abbey of the Arts. And there is an idea of, based on the Annunciation, the angel came down and told Mary, Baba, you're going to be the mother of God. And she said, really, me, yada, yada. But the concept of Annunciation and angels and those moments, Annunciation as a meditation, contemplating your life, can come in any form. So in this case, we could say that your father was the angel of the Annunciation of your path into being a documentary playwright.
Oh, definitely.
Right? Now, do you recall any moments like that in your formative years or even later where your mother presented you with an idea or presented you with a question? Because I remember your mother was a great question person.
Oh, she would was amazing.
Investigate, like she would pull out of one what your intention was, is my memory of her. Is that correct? Or like she knew how to ask the right things. Is that correct?
She did.
Is there
What I most remember though about my mother was not about the subject matters. It was I would always read my plays to her.
Oh, gosh.
And I would play all the parts.
That's how you became such a great actor.
No, actually, that's not how, but I will tell you someday if you want to know.
Okay.
And you're right. She would ask questions, and I would ask her questions, like, did your interest ever flag, or did you have questions about such and such and such and such, and she would always be careful never to be critical.
Yeah.
She would always ask it in terms of what she felt. So I remember when I read my play, Mrs. Packard, to her, which she adored, she said, do you want me to be angry at her at times and lose my care for her? Because sometimes I just want to shake her and, you know, talk some sense into her. I said, oh, that's so interesting. Where, Mom? And so she would tell me the places. And
oh, gosh, Emily.
It was because she would just feel it completely as she heard it. And so she was like the perfect emotional barometer of an audience for me. And I would always look at what she was responding to. And sometimes she was just very nicely saying, I lost sympathy and I don't think I should, that you've tipped it too far. But she would never say that. She would say, do you want me to want to shake her and dislike her? And, you know,
do you know, Emily, that is in your energy as a director?
Yes.
You approach
us. I direct like my mother.
You direct like your mother.
Yeah, I am my mother when I direct.
Oh, isn't that really marvelous?
I actually know that.
I want to read something to you because you just described your mother as, you started off by talking about your mother as being able to listen without judgment. I want to read a quote about you, and then I'll tell you who it's from. And I just got this last night. She is a rare playwright and screenwriter who knows how to listen without prejudging what is worth listening to. And her plays, because they are more bottom up than top down, it is unusual and especially valuable. Gloria Steinem.
Oh.
So you were just describing your mother and Gloria was describing you in the same way last night that you described your mother.
Oh my God.
I'm getting goosebumps because you have your mother and your father and now Gloria are all angels in your enunciated path in different ways, but along the same recognition, because Gloria was talking about, she said, I hadn't a clue how to see my own life as a narrative. I was into individual trees, but I couldn't see the forest, but Emily could see the forest. Yeah.
Oh my God, how beautiful.
I know, I know. Yeah, I emailed her and said, do you have that sentence about Emily? And you know, Gloria doesn't get back right away. At least that's not mine. Whoa, it was right there.
Wow.
I know. It was really sweet. It was really sweet. And I said, you have a deadline. It's tomorrow.
She loves deadlines.
Well, if they're right there in front of her, right?
Yeah.
It's so great. But I think that a lot of our listeners are young women in developmental years, and there's so many ideas about how an artist becomes an artist that don't really, it's not true. And so I like to get inside and find out really what were seminal moments where you had what like Oprah calls the aha moment, where you went, this is my path. This is a writer I need to work with. Like there's three male writers in your career that jump out at me without having to look, that I know that you've done extensive work with: Edward Albee, Athol Fugard, Chris Durang. How did you know that these men could be trusted? How? That
Tennessee
question,
Williams.
Tennessee Williams? How did you know? I mean, I'm not saying that you approach life not trusting men or male playwrights. That's not what I'm implying, nor am I implying that anyone should. But the kind of work that you do as a director and as a producer of theater and as a creator, it requires a kind of openness and trust with the people you're working with. And you spend a lot of your life trailblazing for women against the sort of patriarchal structures. So how did you know that these men, these particular writers, had the kind of, I don't know, elasticity of soul or something that you would be, or didn't you know? You just love their work and you dove in, or you, how did it happen with these? Because they're big deals, these men.
They are big deals. And each one of them, it's different, actually, because I guess it was each one of them showed great respect for me. So I could trust them. I didn't feel I had to prove myself. You know, Edward Albee loved my writing.
But how did you know that he did? How did you find that out?
He told me.
No, but I mean, did you reach out to him first? Did he reach out? I'm trying to get to the bottom line of those moments where a young woman, a playwright, an artist in a culture that isn't necessarily 100% supportive of the female process, right?
To put it mildly.
Put it mildly and politely. Has enough confidence to reach out or get in touch with Tennessee Williams or Edward Albee or Athol Fugard, or they reach out to you because they've read a piece of your work. Mm-hmm. How does it happen?
Well, each one was different. I knew Chris Durang from college.
Oh, God.
I was He was a senior and I was a freshman in the only playwriting course at Harvard. And Professor William Alfred taught the course. He was a playwright and a class assist. And we had to read our work in class. And I was the only freshman he ever admitted. And I was so nervous to be around all these upperclassmen. And then, of course, William Alfred said about Chris Durang, he is an important new American voice, and we will hear about him in the American theater. And right after that, you know, he asked me to read my little play. And I did. And Chris loved it.
Yeah.
And told me he loved it. And then he got very famous. And when I got here, I was talking to my friend Wendy Wasserstein, and I asked her if she would like a commission. And she said, no, but who really needs a commission right now is my pal, Christopher. He's just been beaten up by the critics in New York, and he's really low, and he's really depressed, and he needs a boost. So I said, well, he'll never remember me. And she said, oh, he talks about you all the time. I'm like, what? So I got in touch with Chris, and he immediately said yes. And we got together after, 35 years? No, 20 years.
Yeah.
And he said, oh, my God, I'd love to write a play for you. And that's how it started. And we got back in touch, and it was just fantastic. I think I got off the track of what you were asking me. How did I, all those incredible, legendary writers? And, well, the first one was Tennessee let me into his heart because he'd heard about my production of Glass Menagerie, and his brother had seen it and said it was at the Guthrie with John. And Barbara Brin, and it was amazing.
And his brother saw the play? Is that correct?
Tennessee's brother saw the play, and he said it was his favorite production that he'd ever seen of it. And he called his brother and told him that.
Wow.
So Tennessee called me to ask me if I would direct. You don't know this story? His last play at the Goodman?
Well, I know a little bit about it, but the listeners don't.
Right. A House Not Meant to Stand. Little did I know it was his last play. Mm. And of course, I worshipped him. I was, 27, 28 years old. I was a baby. Wow. And he sent me his draft. At this point, he was drinking a lot, of course, and having a very rough time. And it was a mess at that point. I was too young to know what to do with it. And he said, oh, Miss Emily, you will just come down to Key West and live with me. And we'll wake up every morning and write together. And it was like, oh my God, I have to do this. And then I knew all about the, you know, crazy stuff that was going on in that house and all the gay orgies and then all of that, all the drinking. And at the last minute, I just panicked and I said no. And I, for at least 25 years, kicked myself for not having the courage to do it. And then I remember I was in D.C. Mm. I was doing an interview with Kate Blanchett after she asked me if I would do an interview of her after she played Blanche at the Kennedy Center.
Right.
And I did. And I went to see Michael Kahn, who had his theater there and worked with Tennessee a lot. And I told him this story. And I said, you know, he's talking to Kate Blanchett and Liv Ullmann, who directed it. And they all wanted to be, when are you going to direct Streetcar? And I kept saying, you know, I don't need to. You've just done such a wonderful job. And Liv Ullmann said to me, no, you owe it to Tennessee. And I went and I told her the story. She said, no, 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 I bet you did the right thing. And I was going, yeah, she's just trying to make me feel better. And I went to see Michael. And Michael said, that may have been the smartest decision of your life, because Tennessee talked about you till the end and he thought you were wonderful. And if you had gone down there, it would have taken you years to recover if you ever did.
Whoa, this is so interesting. And so you had a feeling of, no, this is, I can't.
I can't.
And you thought for years, you beat yourself up about that. It was a huge regret. Why wasn't I braver? Why didn't I recognize? How could I say no? It was Tennessee Williams. How silly was I to, who did, you know, whatever we do in our spoiler voices. And yet, it probably preserved your relationship with him. And
Yes. And my sanity, from what it sounds like, yeah. But it preserved my relationship with him to the end. That's right.
Is there any moment in your life where you said no, even though it was a difficult no, you knew right then and there it was correct? Do your no's often have to have like a period of revelation afterwards? Because quite often they know there is later on, you know, the perspective of, I guess it was the right thing, but I didn't know at the time. But sometimes I think we do know that our no is correct, even though it goes against everything. Is there anything else as an artist that you remember?
I've turned down a couple of things that I wish now I hadn't turned down.
Mm-hmm. You wish you
had not.
Yes.
Yeah. That the regret remained. The regret with Tennessee did not remain. I have a couple of, well, really only one or two, where I said no to projects too soon.
That's a good lesson for people.
Yes.
And when you said no, though, in those cases, do you remember what it felt? What was driving your no? And then you look back and go, that was too quick. What was it that pushed you into?
I listened to others.
Ah, there you are. That's what we're looking for. That's a pearl dive.
Yes.
Right?
And didn't trust myself. I trusted them over my own gut response. I've only done that three times, and those have been the wrong decisions.
And when you don't listen to yourself, or didn't in those three instances professionally, and you still know that those were wrong decisions that didn't change with time, do you understand what it is about your life at any particular point as an artist that made you more vulnerable to the opinions of others or sort of cultural impulses that may have taken you off of your instinct? Is there a pattern?
Well, two out of the three were because of the man I was with at the time.
That's a great answer. Oh my gosh.
I needn't say any more than that, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You were influenced by a probably brilliant man who had a different opinion, and you gave it up. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow. So
I'm ashamed to say it, but.
No, you should be. No, the thing is, though, Emily, I mean, let's look at this. You are entering, as we talked about together, you are entering another act, the third act of this extraordinary play you have written. Everything that you have done is an example for younger people. And sharing it is gold, because there are women and men out there that are trying to become authentically themselves through the work and do many work and create story that matters to them. And the amount of overriding influence on their instincts, I think it's overwhelming because of technology. So how is a young person to know, how are they supposed to know what they feel in their gut? Because there's so much input. And secondly, how do they develop trust? Well, listening to you talk about your vulnerabilities without shame, you know, can really help support people. Do you see young people struggling with too much input as artists, or have you not seen that?
I see them struggle with a combination of things. Some of it is too much input.
Yeah.
Some of it, in my opinion, is lack of opportunity, which is huge. And I mean, there was always a paucity of opportunity for all of us, and certainly for women and people of color all along. But for all artists, you have to find a way to be true to yourself, and out of that, find the offerings that feel essential to others. And that's a hard thing to find. And you know, part of being a real artist is your vulnerability and lack of arrogance, and, you know, and yet you need so much courage to get it out there at the same time. But you're vulnerable to outside forces because you are vulnerable if you're creating. Yeah. And when you're in that creative state, you're incredibly vulnerable and insecure. I don't care if you're Stephen Sondheim.
Oh, you know,
I don't care who you are. You don't know whether what you just created works, lands, matters, doesn't matter, right? How old you are. Yeah. I saw it in Edward Albee. I saw it in Tennessee. I saw it in Chris. I saw it in all the legends I've worked with. It's all that incredible insecurity. And then they have to find their way to gather themselves and forge ahead. And some of them do it with more grace than others and with less self-destructiveness than others.
Yes, right.
You know what I'm talking about.
Right there is an option. We've all felt it.
Oh,
you know, vulnerability, it leaves you as well open to the numbing of that. And the numbing
and
of that
course,
is what...
That's the death of your art, when you numb yourself. Yeah.
Right.
So all I can say is I don't know whether it's any harder to be a young artist coming of age now. Well, in the COVID moment, of course it is. But pre the last few months, it's always been hard.
Right.
It's just differently hard, I think, with each generation.
Right.
But there's also this need for mentorship right now. I guess we always have the need, but I never had one. I never had anyone championing me, except my parents.
Except your parents. Which gave you a foundation that allowed a kind of, I think, a kind of confidence where it wasn't that you didn't need a mentor, but a mentor wasn't essential to you driving yourself forward.
Oh, I needed one. I just didn't have one. In fact, it was the opposite. There were all the obstacles put in the way saying, women can't do this. Women can't do this. You can't do this.
Yeah.
And I had, thank God, the incredible belief behind me of my parents believing in me so much that I could do what I wanted to do if I worked hard enough at it and if I was good enough at it. They were there for me. And so when I was told no, I would say no is not an option. I'm doing this.
I wanted to ask you about that because I read somewhere and or I've heard, I don't know, but you have said it over and over. You never allowed barriers to stop you. And when I hear that, I get very excited. As a woman, as a young person, as an elder, you know, you don't allow barriers to stop you.
Yeah.
Then I go, but how does that happen? That a young woman at 25 or 28 or 32 or 35 dealing with the barriers, how do you have something inside of you that disallows those barriers to stop you when the culture isn't setting you up for that?
Well, I think that I have a bottomless well of rage and outrage in me.
I love that.
That's perfect. Talk about that. What do you mean? Were you born with it?
Well, you know the story when I was graduating from college and my friends were going off and they didn't know, oh, should I go off and become a movie director or should I go off to New York and become a theater director and writer and which way should I go? And I went to my college advisor, and mind you, I was sort of the little star of my college, right, and doing writing, directing, all that. And he said, oh my dear, I'm so sorry, I should have told you earlier, you may be quite talented, you know, but women can't direct professionally in this country. You should think about going into children's theater.
Yeah, that was the female route.
Right. And I remember the physical sense, it's like the top of my head blew off with rage. And it was like, I stuffed it. I didn't tell him. I just basically said to myself, oh, you fucking watch me.
Yeah. Yeah.
I am doing this. I'm good at this. It's what I want to do. You are not telling me I can't do this.
Yes.
And I was an angry young woman. And Gary loves this young woman. I guess I not only can't stand it when other people are unjustly stopped from being able to live full and fulfilling lives, I also somehow knew it wasn't right to stop me.
Right.
And I think I get that from, well, I would say both parents, but my mother in particular on this one.
Oh, that's me.
Yeah, she had it. She was like the iron butterfly. On the one hand, she would listen without judgment, but she was incredibly critical. And she could smell a rat of a person a mile away.
Oh boy, that's so good.
And she always told me that I was a little too soft and too trusting and too open to people. And she was right about that. And she said, you have a good nose. Use it.
Wow. That's amazing.
And it took me till my close to my end of my second act to say that I now can smell a rat as well as my mother could. And I now know who's who. It's like when I moved to Princeton, I ever tell you this story? And I was so shocked at how segregated it was and how anti-Semitic it was. And I was
at tell our listeners what year it was. Do you remember?
When 1990. Sorry. It was pretty late in the day, right? And I was at a cocktail party with major donors, big money. And I had just started the job, and I knew that I needed these people to give money to the theater in order for the theater to survive. And they were in a little class, and they, you know, I can pass. They didn't know I was Jewish. And they were saying all kinds of anti-Semitic comments. Oh my God, I hear so-and-so's daughter's going to marry a Jew. I don't know, but we've got to go in. All of this stuff.
Oh my goodness.
And I sort of didn't say anything, and I was hating myself. And then I got out of there, and I called my mother. I said, oh my God, I'm such a coward. Just, oh no, you did the right thing. Now you know who's who.
Yeah. Oh, she's
And I still do know.
So your mother was very political. She was very politically sound. Yeah. Which is incredibly important in the theater, would you say?
Oh, incredibly. Oh. She knew how sometimes you would have to jockey, but you have to know who you can trust and who you cannot trust.
Yeah.
And it took me, I made some mistakes on that, big mistakes all the way through. But she was right, and I've really learned it over the years. And now, being in the elder's seat, I see it so clearly.
Yeah, I know, right?
I see those who are two-faced. I see the machinations people are making behind the scene, who's knifing who in the back. I mean, I see it. Yeah. I think I didn't want to see it when I was younger. Now I want to see it.
Well,
and I like knowing it.
Didn't you feel when you were younger? I know that I had this experience where I would see it and I would turn away from it because I didn't trust that I had the tools to survive confronting it.
Oh, definitely right. Yes, I would say that was the same for me, that I was going to get emotionally obliterated. Yeah, I didn't.
Right.
Yeah.
Talk about taking to the third act. I think for the first time in my life, I can confidently approach confrontation without the fear of being emotionally obliterated.
Me too. I've gotten rather good at it. I've gotten to actually look forward to it.
It's going to be a fun 3 decades at least that you have ahead of
you. I mean, right? I've always said I can't wait to be an old lady and I can say whatever I want. And I've earned the right to say whatever
Like Gloria says in her play, say whatever the hell I think.
Now, I'm getting there. It's a great feeling.
Yes. Let me ask you a question about the theater and the future, but specifically New York, because I remember having a conversation with you a long time ago, actually, and I know you've spoken about this, and this is in the core of your feelings about the theater. Do you think that
the idea of a national theater center in New York will ever take hold? Do you think perhaps
no,
COVID is the potential?
I don't know if there should be a national theater in New York.
Okay. You did it.
I did, and yeah. I've changed. I think the National Theater is all of the not-for-profit theaters all around the country.
Right.
Including those in New York.
Right.
I mean, why would Lincoln Center with three stages be our National Theater? Why would the Public Theater, even though it has more stages and does more work, why would we, you know, dub it our National Theater? I don't think it's healthy. We're too big a country.
What was it that you thought you wanted in that way when you felt having a national theater, having a place? I think I remember you saying something about you didn't feel like that beautiful place that were being written around the country were breaking into.
Yes, at one, that's exactly right. At one point, I thought, wouldn't it be amazing to have a national theater, something of the size of the National Theater in London,
yeah,
where the great work from around the country came and was seen, because yeah, New York is still has the biggest population, and it's where the most is written about the work and the publishing happens and all of that.
Yeah.
But I don't know that I see that now. And, you know, I wish I could say perhaps that all the online work could help make a national theater. But you know what? The theater,
no,
it's live. I mean, I've been watching a lot of, you know, the recorded stuff, and a lot of it's valiant, but it, especially if I've seen that same piece live and then I watch it, it's wonderful to be reminded, but it does not replicate the experience.
Right, right. I understand.
So I'm of many minds on this. I All think, right. Mayor,
yeah,
that one, we're going to learn a lot from this experience. I think we're going to get back as we did in the 60s. And 70s with Grotowski and the empty space is going to be a new, mm-hmm, what are the essentials of theater? I think,
yeah,
we're going to see that, which is exciting to me. I think also we're going to have learned how we can all gather in a particular way through electronics and the virtual platform. And we'll see from that why that isn't theater, but we can also perhaps see a way to make theater have a broader reach, so that I think it would be wonderful to be able to find portals in so that you can be in Israel and Italy, and I'm looking at the eyes, Iceland and Ireland and,
yeah,
Iowa,
yeah,
and still have a sense of an event that you're sharing.
Right, right.
I don't think we figured out quite how to do it yet, but that, right, we might learn that in this isolated period. There are a lot of things that are brewing that I think could be exciting, but I think we're going to have to rethink old models and go back to core.
And how does,
values,
how does that feel to you? Prior to COVID, did you think you weren't working from core values?
Oh, I think I was.
Yeah.
I have two. One is, I'm so grateful I had the bulk of my career, or my first two acts, before COVID. You know, I've just had an amazing life in the theater. It's been thrilling.
Yeah.
And I felt like I stayed true to what you call your, my authentic self. And I kept growing and stretching and, you know, just loving the experience of living theater every day.
Mm.
What is my third act? Well, I want it to be with you, I have to say.
Ah, thank you. But we could just keep doing podcasts. We'd never have
we
to go
We could just
anywhere.
Keep doing podcasts. Or actually, if will you please become my shrink? You are asking the most amazing questions that get to the heart of so many things. You're incredible.
Yeah.
But I think also there's something exciting at this moment to not know, to be confident that as we're all swimming in these uncharted waters and unknown places, that we're going to make discoveries, and we can't know what they are until we make them, you know? Yeah. And it's sort of like being in that midpoint in rehearsal where you know there's so much more, but you're still diving for those pearls, right?
Yeah.
You haven't found them all. And you're going into deeper and deeper water and colder water, but you still got to make the dive. And I feel like we're going to be going through that for a while.
Yeah,
it's not always a comfortable place to be in because you just don't know. But
no.
The idea of patience and then being open to when that discovery is made, not swimming past it.
You know, placing this moment in that feeling of midway through rehearsal is brilliant, because it just really struck me that that is so correct. Because midway through rehearsal, my experience is, yeah, you're still diving because you haven't strung the pearls yet.
Yeah.
But got to start showing a string. Like there
yes.
has to be form. You're midway through. And
yep.
so there is some form. So we know we have form right now. We know we have structure, but we have to dive for the new. I don't even know how to say it, but it's almost like we know what a string of pearls looks like. We know what a piece of theater looks like. We know what it's looked like since the Greeks.
Right.
Now we have to find out what it will look like after this, or something. I don't know.
But I think if you want to continue that metaphor,
yeah,
you don't
ahead.
Want a pearl necklace that looks like the 50s, right? What are we going to have in 2023, 2025? Maybe those
right.
pearls should be in our hair. Maybe
yeah.
they should be strung across our eyebrows. Who knows?
Yeah, I know.
Where they should go. And then maybe it should only not be just one string. And maybe it should be many. You know, I think
yeah.
that's the other thing. We don't necessarily have, we don't definitely have the form. Because when are we going to actually get in the same space together?
Right. Right. So we don't. Right.
When are we going to be breathing the same air again?
Right.
When are we going to be able to actually touch?
Right.
I mean, sometimes I'll watch a movie now and go, oh, don't do that. And somebody embraces or they kiss, I go, oh, watch out. Yeah. It's stress situation. Yeah.
There have been a lot of articles just in the past few days, which is comforting, both comforting and sort of raise my anxiety level. Because I don't think we're quite ready yet, but we have to start thinking about it. And the article is like, there was one about Tyler Perry Studios in Atlanta. And Tyler Perry has a genius setup down there because basically he purchased years ago, I think what was maybe Civil War era army base or whatever, but it's sort of a huge property and all kinds of structures on it. And he converted it into a film studio, but it also has beautiful little homes everywhere, old probably antebellum. I have no idea. I might be making up the antebellum part. And it's just got this grace to it, but it also can house a lot of people. And so his feeling is he's going to move as quickly as possible. He also writes, directs, and acts and everything. And so it's very spontaneous and he shoots fast because he has all of the hats on. But the idea of bringing in the crew, abbreviated crew, the cast, abbreviated cast, mm-hmm. housing them for weeks on campus.
Right, and probably quarantining them for as long as they need to make sure that they're
right.
virus-free, yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. And bringing in the food, pre-packed, like with airline food. Mm-hmm. And so they have a sterile environment and then they can jump in and shoot. Well, that is an extremely fortunate moment in both film history's life and his life in that he already had the setup.
Right.
Do you know what I'm saying? But the idea in other discussions, Vancouver trying to figure out how they get going with all the films and TV shows that were stopped, Hollywood, everybody trying to negotiate with unions and insurance. How do you insure, and what different levels of insurance do actors require now because of different ages in the era of COVID?
Right.
I'm going to be mighty expensive. No, I'm kidding. Well, I might be. And you know what I mean? Because we are elders. Well, they're not going to not put, no one's not going to put Jane Fonda and Lily Tomlin on TV because they're a little bit of a risk because they're older or et cetera, et cetera. So we have to push the envelope, but there won't be sex scenes in movies for God knows how long. And not only because that would be dangerous, but because it does make audience uncomfortable now to watch it. When will we get over our PTSD of seeing people connect physically? Because we will have PTSD.
Oh, definitely.
We do already. Yeah. And it's well-founded. We have seen suffering, and I'm so glad we get to see it. Hard as it is to be shown on the news or however we get our information. I'm deeply grateful to people like Rachel Maddow. It's bringing in the stories of the frontline workers night after night. But if we did not really get to see this and have these extraordinarily naked, emotionally naked heroes telling us what this disease actually does, we would be in much worse shape because we would not trust the need for stay at home, which some people don't anyway.
Yeah.
But we are developing both a deep and profound respect for human connection and a deep fear that is I don't know how we are going to journey out of that so that even if we could sit in a theater 6 feet apart, what do the actors do on stage? Are they blocked at a distance? Do they not touch? Because that will make us nervous. Answer that first. I have so many questions and I want to make sure I get one of these in. But so answer this first and we'll go to my next one.
Well, I think we're all wrestling with both of those notions. How can we stage again and have the kind of intimacy and connection that we want on stage? When will that happen? And when will actors feel safe enough to do all of that? When will directors, and when will audiences want to see that again? Mm-hmm. But I think I'm not as worried about audiences wanting to see intimate connection. I think they do. Mm-hmm. They get past that initial, oh my God, can you believe I was concerned that someone kissed another person? That's, you know, let me get past that. I want to be here to get past that, right? That I think will be less of the issue than, do I really want to risk my life by going to a theater to see a play or musical or a concert or whatever it is? I have to trust that the theater's done deep cleaning. I have to trust that the people coming in with me will keep a social distance. I have to believe that when I sit down, this everything is clean around me and no one's going to violate this space. I mean, all of that. Even once we're allowed to do it with social distancing, I'm not sure I want, I mean, I can't think of what I would want to see so badly that I would take that risk. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think it's going to be once we have a vaccine.
Of course.
Or we have a treatment.
Yes. Yes.
Because to risk one of the most horrible deaths you can imagine.
Alone.
To go see even the most wonderful play ever written. I don't have that in me.
Yeah.
So no, I respect that fear a great deal. And I think it's going to be a year and a half, 2 years, because we're going to need the vaccine and we're going to need treatment.
Right.
And we're going to need some tried and true coming together. And we find that those people who did do that did not get sick. We need, it's going to take time to build the trust again. I mean, that happened after 9/11 for us. People didn't want to come back into the theater. They were terrified that people gathering together, there would be a bomb.
Correct. Yeah.
So it took 4 years maybe after 9/11 to get the audience back.
Right. Now, do you watch Governor Cuomo?
I do.
So do I. So did you watch him this morning by any chance?
I did not, no.
Okay. I watched him this morning because I like to have coffee with Cuomo. And And because, you know, we're 3 hours behind, so the timing works out. And he and de Blasio outlined the most remarkable thing that I believe they said they were beginning tonight. Starting tonight, I believe, they are disinfecting between the hours of 1 a.m. and 5 a.m. No one can get on a New York City subway. And they will provide alternate transportation by either disinfected van, disinfected Uber, or cars for hire that they will have. The city will have enough fleet to take essential workers to and from work if they need to travel between those hours. Mm-hmm. Because they are coming in with machines and all kinds of new chemicals. And they're going to disinfect the subway system and the bus system.
Fabulous.
I thought, I just want to sign up and work for these dudes. You know what I mean? Yeah. I really want to be part of the army, because the step-by-step movement towards the unknown that they are taking, and taking with flourish and showing profound leadership. And
absolutely, profound leadership.
But just the idea that they are going to create a subway system that's at least 50%, if not more, safer for our essential workers to be riding in right now. Because think about it, they might have the PPE that day when they get to work, but they had to take the subway to get there. They
That's
take
right.
the PPE up and they take it home. And they take the subway home. So where is the safety for that individual? It just doesn't yep. exist. And that, it's a nightmare. And so it's so hopeful. And so you feel like putting our minds into our particular workplace and saying, I don't know, we've never done that before. So what if we, you know, it's exciting.
It is exciting. There are days that I find it so exhilarating.
Nice to hear.
Yeah.
You tell the listeners your particular story at the glorious McCarter as you had to shut down, your shutdown story for COVID. What play, oh. what stage you were at, how it happened, if you don't mind.
No, it happened so fast. We were in the midst of opening a production of Sleuth by Anthony Schaffer, directed by my mentee, Adam Imrovar. It was absolutely brilliant. Two of the best actors in New York. And audiences were adoring it. They were, you know, we'd gone and had two previews. They had jumped to their feet cheering each time. I thought, oh my God, we have a hit. And we were hearing, you know, gosh, this virus is, how bad is this going to be? So from between Sunday and Wednesday, we were beginning to worry, but still, I remember having a meeting Thursday morning. He said, look, opening is Saturday night. We've got to at least get till opening. I think we can do that responsibly. And then Thursday night, only 300 people of the 1,000 people who had bought tickets showed up.
Wow.
And wow. we went, oh my God, this is going really fast. By Friday morning, Broadway said they were shutting down that night. We realized we needed to shut down. I had just come back from London and they were still going strong on the West End. And when I think about it, it's unconscionable they were doing that. But we weren't getting all the information. We
right.
didn't really know what we were facing. And we got in a video crew. We stopped selling tickets. We closed our doors. Everything is where it was Friday noon. This is that Saturday. We captured it on video, hoping that we'd be able to at least give it virtually to our ticket holders, and then sent the actors and the artists home. Paid them for the whole run, paid everything, and then thought, okay, where are we? And I haven't been back in the theater since. None of us has.
That beautiful place, just sitting there alone.
Yeah.
With everything in it, right?
It's a ghost. It's the ghost light is on in the theater. And it's a ghostly place. Our development director sometimes goes in to work there because she has a whole house full of family, all of them quarantined at her house, her daughter and her daughter's boyfriend, or, you know, and so they're all on Zoom at the same time. They can't get any work done. So she goes in and wipes down the office every day and works. Then she says, sometimes it's very comforting and sometimes it's just spooky. The university across the street, you know, the students were sent home within a day or two of when we shut down. But literally it went from in the morning, I think we're going to make it to 2 days from now, 3 days from the opening night, to we're closing within hours. It was so shocking.
Yeah. And when you did close, because it's very interesting for me and the listeners to hear about specific, you know, where were you on 9/11 kind of thing. That's
right.
What this is now. Do you remember what your sensation or expectation was about how long you'd be closed?
At that time,
yeah,
I said, okay, we're saving, you know, keep this set intact. Don't send back any of the rentals. Don't, you know, let's say that maybe we won't go into rehearsal for the next show on schedule,
right?
But we'll come back and remount this. I called the playwright and director that day of the next show to say, and they saying, oh, you're canceling, aren't you? I said, no, we are still looking to see if there's any way, even in the summer, that we can get back and do your beautiful play. And this is my last play as artistic director here, and I love your play, and I'm going to do everything to get it on. And fought and just looked at how we could do it financially, but then realized we couldn't do it ethically, that it looked as if this virus was much bigger than anyone had thought the week earlier.
Yeah.
And that we couldn't endanger lives. So then we looked into, well, can we do it online? Can we looked at we turned it over. I was so loath to give up, but at the end I did. So I guess every day seemed like a year, but I think it took 2 weeks to come to grips with the fact that not only was the end of our season not going to happen, but probably this fall might not happen. And some theaters are saying all of next season will not happen. They're canceling 2021. It has been agonizing, quite frankly. And part of it was my stubbornness of believing we could find a way and not quite understanding that I was trying to, you know, body surf a tsunami.
Well, you weren't alone. You weren't alone. I mean, we were all in that state for 2 weeks. I know I was about to go do a project, and the first, within a few days, and then second project came up in the same time. And it went from, how do these two projects negotiate so that they can share Mary during the same time period, to we're postponing your work, Mary, until the end of the project, because the Canadian government told us we have to quarantine you for 2 weeks the minute you get up here in 2 days, to the end, by the end of that day, both were shut and done. Still, they remain. But, and I remember talking to both showrunners the following week, just to check in, you know, whatever. Mm-hmm. And both the conversations had that element of, well, yeah, we'll, you know, we're doing the right thing. We're being safe. And no one understood yet. None of us did. Really, was about to happen.
We did not know. We were all the beginning of a global catastrophe, and we didn't see the scope of it yet.
Right.
And what I'm so afraid of with our industry, the theater, I'm more worried about the theater, and I don't mean to sound callous, but I am more worried about the theater than I am about film and television, just because we've got that added component of live audience. I know that many theaters that have closed will not reopen.
Because they don't have the money to sustain, right, through this period.
No, it's just heartbreaking. I can't even call it an industry or business in some ways, this art form in our country, which is so much in need of being supported publicly and privately, but we don't have what the infrastructure they have in Europe and England. And I worry that many, many smaller and mid-sized theaters will be history. They will not come back. Now, perhaps, you know, it's a reset, like so much of the planet is resetting. Look at what we're learning about. Maybe we can all come together and deal with climate change. Maybe we can all come together and deal with ceasefires and wars and all kinds of things together, right? If we all put our minds to it in the right way. Maybe with the washing away of all that has those smaller places that have been, something new, and maybe even those same great minds, thinkers, and artists will come together in a new way and create in a new way. They will create. When you're an artist, you have to create, and you will find a way to do it, right? We know that.
Yeah.
But a lot of the old structures may be wiped clean, may be washed away with this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it's very painful to watch now. Very, very painful. And also, I think about all the artists who have no livelihood, but they've lost their all of next season, all their projects. How are they going to bridge the gap? That is, how are they going to stay solvent?
And look at the industries that usually support artists doing that. The restaurant industry, delivery, cab driving, Uber, all of these industries support the artists.
Absolutely.
All have been compromised. So we are entering a period like none other for artists figuring out how to maintain a life while creating. I hope we're wide awake so that people know how to interpret it and are willing to, the stories about it and how it gets reformed are going to be just extraordinary for people in the future.
Yeah, and some of that is very exciting, along with a lot of grieving and loss.
We're going to
and I'm finding, I don't know about you, but I feel like I'm in emotional whiplash between interest and excitement and grieving and pain. I mean, it's and it can go hour to hour.
Yes, I understand. Hour to hour isn't really quite where I'm living, but I'm definitely living day to day like a roller coaster. Like I can fall asleep at night having gotten in touch with very beautiful things and communicated and done this and feel really good. I can wake up in the middle of the night with a depression so deep.
Me too.
Such as I've never felt before. It's not my tendency. I have other issues.
Yeah.
But, you know, sinking into depression is not my thing. And I wake up in the middle of the night and what is this suffocating sadness and feeling of hopelessness and despair?
Yeah.
And I'm a generally pretty a person who doesn't suffer depression. I am feeling that. What about all of our dear, wonderful millions of friends around the world who struggle with depression on a daily basis?
I know. I'm very worried about them.
Yeah.
And I'm worried about my friends who are always struggling paycheck to paycheck. I'm also worried about my friends with, you know, who struggle with anxiety, depression, and, you know, all kinds of emotional and psychiatric issues. I also am worried about, you know, relationships. That, you know, people are, you know, especially if, you know, if you're just starting out or if you're alone. I mean, how young people are going to meet each other? Are they going to fall in love during this period? And also, if you're in a relationship that is not good, that you're taking care.
And my heart breaks in a different kind of way when I contemplate, because I try to make sure that I sort of go out there and contemplate the real difficulties that certain people are having, whether it's about the poor and how we are having our economic disparity, our disgusting separation.
Oh, it's been all laid bare.
Exposed to us right now through this nightmare of the... But then sometimes I land on a particular day trying to contemplate in a meditation or whatever, men and women and children who are in abusive relationships and can't leave the house.
That's the first thing that went into my mind. I'm so worried. There's got to be quite a number of households that are nightmares right now.
understand how people will survive that. Anyway, we're going to have to close this out for now. This won't be our last one, I have a feeling.
Right. But,
and I know we got into the real dark part of all of this, and I'm glad we did, because I do think that people need to say those things out loud. People are working so hard to feel positive, and that's important too. But the emotional, physical, psychological toll that this is taking is going to change us as a species. So we need to talk about it, you know. So I'm so grateful, Emily, that you were willing to admit your own emotional whiplash. And it's important that people hear that someone like you is going through that too. Do you know? Yeah. It's really important to me now. Before we close, is there anything you want to ask Emily?
I struggle with the idea personally, and I wonder how you feel about it, of this moment being something we embrace and work through and come to the other end and experience differently, the theater, film, TV, all of that, or something where we all put ourselves on ice and say, you know what, fine, nothing's gonna happen for a year, 2 years, and then we're gonna go back once there's a vaccine. How do you see that and struggle with that too? Is there a right way or a wrong way, or is there something more appealing than the other?
Well, I'm always worried about putting oneself on ice. I don't like to be cold, number one. But number two, I think that if you choose to numb yourself and check out and then come back on the other side ready to go, you will not know what the other side is, because the other side will be different. So it won't do you any good to do that. Now, to deeply rest and lie fallow for a while and really listen and really take in what's going on, and then trust that what you will come out with afterwards to give as an artist will have its own validity. That's another way to go. I know that Ethel Fugard always used to say to me, I write for a year, then I lie fallow for a year.
Oh, wow.
How does that work? I don't have rich enough soil, he said. So when you don't, and you learn that in different areas of Africa, where he comes from, where there's, you know, you can't deplete the soil, you lie fallow. He said, and that can be a very rich time. So I think those writers in particular who feel like they've got to be responding to this moment. Everyone's built differently. I'm writing a love story right now. I don't feel ready to write about this moment.
Right.
I need to feel that I have to live through this and have some perspective on it before I'm going to be writing about it, I think. So I would say don't put yourself on ice, but either grapple with it very energetically and find ways to work through it and be creative at this moment, or let yourself lie fallow and trust that there's a lot of going on in your subconscious and unconscious that will come out the other side, and deeply listen, continue to listen, because that's really at the end of the day how one can respond as an artist to what is going on, to let it enter you.
Thank you.
Wow. Well, that's a wonderful place to end. I'm very excited for all of you to hear this podcast.
This is crazy. My iPad just went out, so I'm on my phone. And what I would love is if there's anything you would like to say to kind of end this wonderful, wonderful moment together.
Well, one thing that I would just love to say is that whenever I'm in your company, Mary, I grow, I learn, I stretch as a human being, and my spirit just soars. So I know why your fans love you so much. And I suppose I'm not just your dear, dear, dear friend and comrade in art. I'm also your fan. I love you so much. Thank you for this.
And we me. I love you too. You know that. I love you deeply. And I will just say this, and then we will shut down, is that you mentioned earlier that you did not have a mentor and you needed one. I did have a mentor, and it was you. And I could not have become the actor that I was. I did not understand the artist that I am, except that I had the good fortune of meeting you at a very young age, and we were the same age, but you were light years ahead of me in your understanding of being a woman and being an artist. I thank you for that. I love you dearly, Mina. I love you too. Everyone, stay home.
Yeah.
Oh, keep staying home, stay safe. And this is Lady Bam signing out. We'll be back soon with a couple more podcasts. We're just going to keep going here as much as we possibly can. We have many more wonderful adventures coming up. Everybody stay safe. We love you. And this is Lady Bam and Mina Sharp, our amazing producer, signing out. Love you. Bye.